Okay, well, with all of that out of the way, welcome everybody. This is Intro to Git. This is our second GitHub Git workshop that we've done as part of ORSAT. I'm Dimitri. I mostly do software, firmware, and sysadmin-y stuff. Joe's with me today, and he's going to be helping out. If you guys got any questions, if you have questions in the middle of a slide or anything like that, feel free to post it in chat, and Joe will probably be able to get to you and help you out. Before we get into it, hopefully you guys have done some of the prerequisite stuff, i.e. getting Git installed on your machine and getting that good to go. If not, we'll kind of peruse over that in just a second here. But yeah, with that said, let's get on into it, or get on into it. I'm funny. Just kidding. Okay, well, let's start off with a pretty simple question. What is Git? Well, it's a source control manager. It's a way of tracking changes to a set of files over time, right? Obviously, this was pretty primitive, and there were other alternatives to Git way, way, way long ago in the late 90s, early 2000s. A lot of different variations of this. Git primarily came from a dude named Linus Torvalds. You might know him because of the Linux kernel. Actually, kind of funny side note about that. They used to use this thing called BitKeeper, and then there was a lot of pedantry that went on. And BitKeeper started, they originally were letting people use it for free so long as it wasn't, so long as they weren't making competing products, and they didn't like something that Linus was doing, so they stopped giving him BitKeeper license for free. And then Linus was like, screw you, I'm gonna make my own SVN. And here we are today, we have Git. Its primary job is to track changes, and it can do a lot more than that. It's a very powerful and versatile tool, but its core job is tracking changes, and we'll see where some of that is powerful and where some other misconceptions about what it does later. So real quick, hopefully you already have Git installed. If not, this is these are some resources right here that should get you up and good to go real quick. Linux is some of the easiest stuff. Sometimes it ships, depending on your Linux distribution. Sometimes it already ships with Git. Sometimes it doesn't. And if it doesn't, then it depends on your package manager. So Debian, Ubuntu, Mint is all apt-get install or apt-install Git. Things like Arc or CentOS. Well, CentOS is Yum, and Red Hat is RPM, and Arc is Pac-Man or Yay, depending on what stuff you have. Mac, I think, is Homebrew. Windows, you just straight up have to download a binary from Git Bash. Git Bash is, if you're on Windows, it is probably the most recommended way of getting Git, not just because you get Git, but also you get a couple of tools that you're gonna need later. And by later, I mean in like five-ish minutes. So that should be something that should be helpful. There may be a little few caveats to come though, but we'll see. Great resource in general is getsem.com. Getsem.com, if you ever want to know anything about a particular feature, we're going to cover a lot, but we're still not going to cover everything. There's oodles of stuff that's just never, we don't have the time to cover. Getsem is kind of like one of the many ways that you can learn about anything about Git. It has all kinds of documentation that is absolutely great. And then of course, once you have Git, the command line tool itself installed, Git help this flag, this double dash help, gets you a nice little menu that tells you quite a bit. And I could give you an example. It gives you this, right? And it gives you all of the top level things that you can do, which can be a good way of remembering, like, oh, here's how to set up a working environment, and then here's how to work in my environment that I've already set up, which we will get into in a bit. Of course, the next piece of the homework that I gave you guys is getting a GitHub account. GitHub is, of course, how OrSat posts all of our code, and we also have our own organization, OrSat GitHub. Whoops. Right here. So hopefully you are already a member of this organization. And if not, contact me or contact Joe, and we can get you in there, right? Let's see here. And then this link right here will take you to docs. This right here is, I think, a mirror of the same docs. And then the man pages, if you're on Linux, if you're on Windows, you may not have this, but the man pages are, it stands for manual pages. And it gives you an even more breadth of documentation.
On Windows, if you follow up any command with dash dash help, it'll open the man page in your web browser.
Oh, there you go. All right, well, there you go. I think Joe will be a useful counterpart to me, because I definitely don't use Windows, definitely not for development anyways. So there's gonna be a couple of things that Joe may have to step in to fill in.
I wish I didn't have to use Windows, but I'm a mechanical engineer.
That's true. And honestly, actually, I can't totally avoid Windows myself either for other things. Anyway, that's all besides the point. One of the universal rules to life is that there's always a relevant XKCD. So behold the relevant XKCD. I take a moment to appreciate this. All right, moving on. So in this workshop, we're going to be covering the first four commands that you need to know in order to start interacting. And then after that, we're going to kind of cover how to use that to use Git in a collaborative way. So you can kind of think of Git as a history tracker, which can be useful alone, especially if, let's say, you're working on some homework and you want to keep a history of everything you've added to your homework so far, and then maybe you break something and you want to revert. It's useful for that, but it is even exponentially more powerful when it comes to collaboration, and it also gets exponentially more tricky the more people you have working on one project. So it's we're going to be going over some of the do's and don'ts and things to keep in mind whenever you're collaborating. There's another man page called Git Every Day. I don't know if that is also available on Windows or not, but on Linux, it looks like this. And it's kind of a short list of everything you kind of need to use Git in case you ever forget anything, or maybe you're trying to forget how to do a particular feature. This is a nice little nifty short list of how to use Git to accomplish what you're looking to do.
For Windows users in general, if you don't have access to the man page for something, if you just type in a search engine man and then the command, you'll get the result.
That's a good point. Let's see what we get real quick. Git Every Day, manual pages.
Also,
here we go.
Is the video way out of sync from what Dimitri is saying for everyone else? Maybe that's just me. Okay, Felix says it's right for him, so I think it's just me.
Okay. All right, perfect. Cool. So getting back to it, some of the things we weren't going to be covering, the innards of Git. So, you know, I'm not going to be explaining to you SHA-1, although it's very interesting, and it's also interesting how SHA-1 has been cracked at this point. It's not particularly relevant to how to use it. We're also not going to be covering more advanced things like cherry picking, interactive rebasing. Pray that you'll never have to do a rebase, or at least not a a non-interactive merge fixing or anything like that. That's just an absolute mess. We're also not going to be teaching you bash. That's kind of assumed that you have a shell for this. The purposes of this workshop, we're going to assume you have a shell and that you have Git installed. You don't really need to know anything else about bash in order to do this workshop. I think I will show you some of the Git GUIs that are available. Like, I'll show you guys some of my tools that I have, and then also another tool that's available. But I'm not going to go too in depth on them, partially because I don't actually use them too much myself. But also, they're usually just kind of intuitive, click around and you get it yourself, you get into it. Cool. So one of the first things you kind of got to deal with whenever you're setting up Git for the very first time is you got to make sure that you're setting up not necessarily credentials, but an identifier. And this is one of the things that gets confused a lot. Git wants to know who you are, but it's not going to authenticate you necessarily. That's the job of something like GitHub. I think a good analogy is Git is to GitHub as videos are to YouTube, right? So one is the content and the other is the host of the content. And that's exactly what's going on here, right? So Git is the content. It was made independently from GitHub. And then another organization decided to say, hey, how about we make a centralized place where we can host all of this content and add a couple of other convenient features to make development in general easier. And that's where GitHub came from, as well as a lot of other popular alternatives like Bitbucket, GitLab, Git, and more than I could list, really. But this particular set of configs is just for Git. And it really only pertains to making sure you can sign every commit. And we'll explain what signing a commit means later. But for now, just think of this as I'm telling Git how what my signature looks like, right? So this is the way to do it. You say, let's load up this config. And let's say my name is this. It might not even be my GitHub username. Like I put in Dimitri space Migyukin, and that's not my GitHub username, but it's still a name that Git recognizes or Git accepts anyways. And then of course an email, right? So it's just a unique identifier for Git alone. And then of course, there's a setting for an editor, and we'll show you why you need an editor in a little bit. Nano is probably the easiest one, right? Nano is definitely the easiest one, especially if you're not too familiar with Git. Not too familiar with Vim, but of course, feel free to use any editor you like. I think there's a special way. Well, actually, yeah, those are different Git tools, but there are special ways to set this if you're not doing it via the command line, but that's how you do it via the command line. And then of course, at the end of the day, once you are all done setting all of that up, you can check it again with list, which should tell you exactly, there we go. This will tell you exactly all of your settings, right? So here we go. At the very top, I've set my name, which is this, and then my email, which is that. We might blur that for YouTube, actually. Actually, maybe not. It's already public info. I've doxed myself before. And then the editor right here. I also have a bunch of other settings. Most of these settings are not stuff that we're going to go over, but the important things are the user.name, user.email, and the editor, which in this case is Vim, but I could easily change that to Nano if I needed to. So this will probably one of the few exceptions to one of the things I just said, which is it is kind of I see a question in there, and the question asks, does the name need to be in quotes? It is not necessary so long as whatever is in there doesn't have spaces. But this is a quirk of Bash. If you have a space in there, then you'll want to wrap that in quotes. So if you say Dimitri space Migukin, then you'll want to wrap that in quotes because Bash will think that it is multiple words or multiple arguments. But yeah. But if it's all one, then it's not required. But it's a safe way to go either way, right? So that's config in a nutshell. Get config. If you go to your home directory on any Linux-based environment that you're in, if you go to your home directory, it's going to make a file called getconfig.getconfig, and it's going to be a hidden file. And you can actually also open that up. And what you're going to see is it's actually in the standard called config. I know that's confusing, but it's in a standard called config, and you can also see your settings this way and edit it this way as well. And you will see all of the same things, right? So here's my name, my email, a signing key. I might, if we have time, we'll briefly go over what that is. And then of course the editor, right? And you can also change all of the settings that way. Although through Git is a valid way to go too. All right, so a quick overview of SSH, because we're gonna also go over real quick how to get set up with an SSH key, an RSA key, and get that hooked into GitHub. GitHub no longer allows for HTTPS authentication, which means that if you tried to go through and make a commit and make a push and push content to our repos on GitHub, if you did it over HTTPS, what it would do is it would ask you for your email, and then it would ask you for your password. Right. Well, not only is that inconvenient because you have to enter your email and password, but that's also a little bit old fashioned in terms of authentication. So for two things, one, it's easier to use RSA keys in the long term. And secondarily, GitHub disabled the old way of logging in anyways. Git itself uses the SSH protocol. Right. So really all that's going on is file transfers, right? Or sorry, GitHub uses the SSH protocol in order to upload stuff to their servers. SSH, just a brief overview of what it is. It stands for Secure Shell. It uses what's called an asymmetric key pair, and we'll see how to generate this in just a second. What that means is you're gonna generate two files. You're gonna generate a private key, which is secret to you. You keep to yourself and you never, ever, ever share it with anybody, and it never, ever, ever leaves your machine. And then you generate a public key. That public key is what you give to everybody and anybody. You say, hey world, here's my public key. If you ever wanna send me data, use this public key in order to sort of communicate with me, right? And then of course, down here are my, points that I had just made. Never share your private key, right? And I'll show you an example of what a private key looks like in just a second. And never move your private key over the internet. This is a pitfall that I've seen a couple of times. People try to use the same RSA key over multiple machines. Don't ever do that. Because your RSA key is supposed to be unique per machine because it's generated on the machine that it's used for, if that makes sense. All right, so this is probably the easiest git, the easiest git command, or not git command, but easiest command you'll have to run all night, SSH key gen. And that's it. No arguments, no nothing. Let me actually, I almost forgot. This is super tiny to you guys. So let me know if that's still too small, but if you run a SSH keygen and you don't give it any arguments, what it's going to do is it's going to create two files for you, and it's going to create them with the default names, right? IDRSA and IDRSA.pub. IDRSA is your private key. That's the one you never, ever, ever share with anybody. And the .pub is, of course, the public key. When you generate it, there's an option to add a passphrase. It's optional. If you add a passphrase to your RSA key, then every time you commit and push, you will have to re-enter this passphrase. It's an added layer of security if you feel like you want to also encrypt the, it's just an added layer of security to not complicate it too much, but it is optional and it's not necessarily necessary. But if you just sort of breeze right through that, then it's going to say, your identification has been saved to this location. So, okay, great. If we go there, then what we're going to see is we get an IDRSA and then an IDRSA.pub, right? That's great. So now what do we do? Well, it's time to give it to GitHub, right? So what we're going to do is you're going to go to github.com, and assuming you already have your account and it's already validated and verified, what you're going to do is you're going to go up here to the settings. You're going to go up to the right corner, and then settings. And then once you're in your settings page, there's going to be a tab called SSH and GPG keys. And this is where we're submitting it to GitHub, right? All right, great. There's this menu, and this tells you, hey, this is all of the SSH keys you got. This is all the GPG keys you got. We're going to go up here and say, we want to submit a new SSH key, right? And now this is the box where you're going to want to submit the contents of this file. Not this file, this file. The one with that pub at the end, right? It's an important distinction because this one inherently doesn't have any extension. And if you accidentally submit it anywhere, then you might consider that key exposed and invalid, and you probably shouldn't use it anymore. So I say, okay, great. Let's get my pub key. And this is what it looks like, right? It's a bunch of garbled string. And at the end, it's going to say, this is my username plus my domain, right? So maybe there's going to be an email there sometimes, or if you're on a Linux system, then it'll show you. So you take that content and you paste it into here, and then you give it a nice little title, right? So my RSA key, right? And then you hit submit. It's going to ask you for your password. And then you hit submit, and then there you go. Now you have your RSA key. So now you should be set up. There might be a couple of other caveats to this process if you're on Windows, just because Windows is a different platform and it doesn't necessarily handle the SSA agent the same. But barring that, this should be all you need now in order to get set up with pushing to GitHub, right? So now what's going to happen every single time you sign a commit and then you push is Git is going to try and search for your RSA key here. And if it finds it, then it's going to try and use that to log in, quote unquote, log in to GitHub's servers. And if it succeeds in logging in, then it just pushes the content and you're on your way. It doesn't ask you for an email. It doesn't ask you for a password. So it's a lot more convenient in that sense too, not only more secure, which is very nice. Because this file is going away at the end of this workshop, I'll show you what it looks like. This is what your private key looks like. And it explicitly tells you, begin open SSH, private key. This is your private key. Never share this, right? Never share this with anybody. It should never leave your computer. Yeah, just wanted to reiterate that real quick. Cool. All right, so that is set up.
Can I ask you to go over those steps one more time, starting from keygen?
Sure. So if we do it again, right, the steps are just, in a nutshell, the steps are just SSH keygen, like that, this command right here. Can you guys see that font size okay? Or does it need to be any larger?
That's great.
All right, cool. So SSH keygen, this program right here is just generating your key for you. And it's going to ask you a couple of questions. First of all, it's going to ask you, hey, do you want to rename the output file, right? So I could say, yes, I do want to rename it. If you wanted to, I would recommend just keeping it as is, unless you want to do anything fancy, like multiple RSA keys, which most of you probably won't need. But it's going to tell you right here at the end, this is what it's going to name it. It's going to name it IDRSA. And if you just hit enter, then it's going to go with the default, right? And it's going to ask you another question. Hey, do you want to add a passphrase to this? And if you decide to hit enter, you're basically saying, no, I don't want a passphrase. But if you do, then you enter it in. Enter it in there, and then it will ask you again confirmation of the passphrase. And if you kind of just breeze through all of that with the defaults, then it's going to tell you, OK, great. Your identification has been saved to this location. Great. And this is the fingerprint. It's not necessary for you to know the fingerprint or what the fingerprint even means, but it's some interesting info that may be relevant later in your life. All right, so the next step, right? The next step is giving it to GitHub, let me be more specific, giving your public key to GitHub, right? So you go to your home, right? You're in your home, and then there's a hidden directory called .ssh. You go into .ssh, and this is where we are. And you can see we have two files in here, IDRSA and IDRSA.pub. Those are the files that we're interested in, specifically IDRSA.pub. So we're going to check out the contents of IDRSA.pub, and we want to give this information to GitHub. You with me so far?
Yeah.
All right, cool. So in GitHub, let's say we're at the home directory, right? You go up here to the right corner, the icon here, and then you go down to your settings. And then in your settings, there's a tab on the left that says SSH and GPG keys. That's where we're going because we're trying to submit an SSH key. And then once we're in here, we say, we want to submit a new SSH key. So we click on that. And then your pub information goes in this box. All that track good?
Yep, got it.
All right. That's all there is to it, assuming you're on a Linux system or assuming that the Windows system is not too variant. Git bash and all of that is not too variant from that. And here's the same deal, just in the slides. And this is what it looks like. And of course, again, just because I can never reemphasize this enough, your private key will say, this is the private key, and don't share that ever. Okay, great. So now that that's all out of the way, we kind of got done with some of the more administrative stuff. Let's actually look at how to create stuff, right? So now it's time, we have our Git identifier And now we also have GitHub authentication sort of set up. And now let's look at how to actually make something, right? So the first way is you could do it is by standalone. So let's make a directory. I'll just call it demo, right? So I have this directory called demo, and I go into that directory. So now I'm in my demo directory, and it's empty. There's nothing in here, but I want to make it a Git repo, right? I want to make it a Git repo locally, right? Well, the fastest way to get set up with that is just Git init. And it tells me a bunch of information here. It says, using master as the name for the initial branch. This is the default branch name. And then it tells me a bunch of other information, like this is how to set up the default branch name if I wanted to change that. And then also, if I wanted to change the branch name, this is how I would do that. The current branch name, this is how I would do it. And then it tells me, great, I initialized an empty Git repository in this particular directory. So I'm in downloads demo, and then it also tells me that I have this hidden folder called .git, right? And this is going to be consistent across all your repos. There's going to be a hidden repo called a hidden directory called .git, and that's actually where Git does all of its magic. It saves all of its magic there. But you say, okay, great. This is how you initialize a repo locally, and anytime you want to start local and then push remote, then you would do it this way, right? So you could just add all of your files, and you can commit and such, and be on your way. What happens if you want to put something onto GitHub and maybe you want to start from GitHub? Well, you can start by cloning, which is going to be the most common way of doing this. You can start by cloning a pre-existing repo, or you can start by creating a new repo. And we'll just go over this real quick. Why not? If I just said, I want to create a new repo and I call it demo, and I can call it a description and stuff. And there's some public private options here, and then a few other options that we'll go over in depth later. These are your options, and this is GitHub specific, but a lot of this is a little more self-explanatory. Yep.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I just want to point out your screen looks really small on my screen, so in a recording it might look even smaller.
Oh yeah, here we go. Is that good?
Yeah, it's much better. Thank you.
All right, there we go. Thank you for letting me know. All right, so these are your options. The field is pretty self-explanatory. This is how you create a brand new repo for yourself. More commonly, what you're going to be doing, especially if you're looking to get started with ORSAT, is you're going to be cloning, right? And how you do a Git clone, especially assuming you have SSH set up at this point, what you're going to do is you're going to click into any repo. So here we are on the organization homepage. And you just find the repo that you're looking for, the repository that you're looking for. We already have this special repo set up for us today called ORSAT Git Workshop. And I can post a link to this in chat as well. So there's the repo that we will be working on. Feel free to clone this, and also feel free to follow along as I'm doing all of these things here. What you're going to do here is there's going to be this green button called code. You're going to click on that, and there's a couple of different options here between HTTPS. I don't know why they have this here. This is disabled now. SSH, which is what we want, and then GitHub CLI. If you have that, then you can work with that instead. But SSH is the most common one to work with. And this is just a link, right? This just says, this is where my repo is at. So git at github.com, that's a little more administrative. That says, this is how to log in over SSH. This is the owner of the repository, ORSAT is the owner, and this is the repo name, .git. And this, I'm not going to get into detail on what that means. But in order to clone, what we're going to do is we're going to do git clone and then the link, like that. And then there we go. It says cloning into this directory name. So it created this directory name in my current directory. And it says, here are all the objects that I retrieved. And here are all the changes that I retrieved and blah, blah, blah. The moral of the story is it's now been downloaded to my directory. So all of these files that are in GitHub are now here, right? So that's cloning. And it does exactly what the name suggests. It clones the repo, right? So those are two of the ways, or technically three of the ways that you can get code from pre-existing places. All right, so now we're actually gonna sort of look into the first four commands that you have to get started with. We just went over clone. And that does exactly what the slide suggests, is it's taking it and it's putting it locally. It's going from remote to local. That's something that is a little bit of nomenclature that might be good to remember. So clone, going local. So the first four commands that you're going to need to know are add, commit, pull, and push. And don't worry about memorizing these right at this instance. We're going to be going over each one, but we're going to start with add and commit. So what does that mean? Well, there's this system in place in Git called staging. And what that means is you're going to make a bunch of changes and they're not necessarily going to stick, or Git is not necessarily going to be keeping track of them yet until you tell Git to do so. And I'll show you what I mean, right? So here we have our Git workshop repo. And if I do a Git status, it's going to tell me you're on branch master, your branch is up to date with origin master. That basically just means nothing has changed between my local copy and the remote copy, right? But let's say I go into the README, or actually let's say, I'll go into the README, right? And say, this is the demo repo for Git workshop. Let's say, hello world. I'm just adding a line of text to this README file. And a README is kind of like a manual. We'll bring it up again later, but it's kind of like a quick start document that says, here's what the repo is and here's some basic things you can do. But all we're doing is we're adding one line of text that says, hello world. And you say, great, well, is GitHub tracking that? Well, actually, no, it's not. It's not tracking it because we didn't tell Git to track it. Or rather, in this particular instance, we told Git to track README, but we did not tell it to update the README or track the changes that I made in the README yet, right? So we have to do this command called git add. And what this says is, hey, Git, I made some changes to README. Put it into staging, right? Which means that I'm trying to bundle a bunch of changes together and I'm going to commit a bunch of changes all at once, but I'm not done making changes yet. So I'm going to say git add, which says add this to the bundle of changes that I'm about to commit, right? And now if I do git status again, it's going to say changes to be committed, modified README, right? And it says, okay, I've tracked your changes in README, but you haven't committed them yet. Meaning the changes have not been set in stone necessarily yet. Let's go over another quick example. So let's say I made a brand new file called Joe, right? And I have this file called Joe, and let's say I put some content in it, right? There's some content. It doesn't necessarily what's in it, right? But if I do git status now, it's gonna say, hey, there's this untracked file here called Joe, right? We could do one of two things here, right? We could say, hey, git, ignore this file because you don't care about it. And if we tell git to ignore this file, then it's never going to show up in our repository, right? it's never going to show up here. And the reason why is because it's going to not pay attention to the fact that this file exists at all, right? Or we could tell it to start tracking this file. And if we did, we would say git add Joe, right? And if we did git status, we would see the updated status of Joe, and it says new file, right? Git status just tells you what the current staging, what the current status of the staging is, if that makes sense. And it tells you, here's all of the things that you have in your bundle right now. In your bundle of changes, this is what you have, and this is what needs to be committed in order for it to be moved back to the remote repository, right? So that's add, right? And the concept of staging is, you start making your changes, you add them to let Git know this is what you should track and this is what you should not track. We'll go over examples of things you might not want to track, and then commit, right? Which is the sort of next step in this process. And commit says, all right, I have all of my changes figured out and I have everything mostly set in stone. So I want to say git commit, and now it pops me into my editor. Now for me, I'm in Vim, but if depending on what editor you set earlier on in the config process, you may come up with Nano, you may come up with Notepad. It kind of depends. I recommend Nano if you're relatively new to dealing in the command line. But regardless, it's going to pop you into an editor. And off the cuff, it doesn't seem intuitive what it's asking for. But then you read this next line here and it says, oh, you're trying to commit and I need to know a message for your changes. I.e., I want you to describe what it is you're trying to commit here. So I say, okay, fair enough. I'm going to say, added the Joe file, updated. And you can make this multi-line as well. If you make it multi-line, you have to have one blank space between your next line and the first one. I think that's just a quirk of, it might just be a quirk of how the text editing works, but updated readme, right? And so I say, okay, great. And then I save that. I don't just exit, but I save and exit, depending on what editor you use. And it says, okay, great. Here's the commit that you just made right here. Here's the commit that you just made right here. Here is the fingerprint of the hash that you just made, right? This is kind of a short identifier for the changes you just made. And it says two files changed, five insertions, one deletion, right? If you really wanted to get into the finite numbers of what happened, right? So I say, okay, what happens if I do git status again? Actually, I'll do clear and then git status, right? What happens if I do git status again? It says, oh, you're on branch master. Your branch is ahead of origin master by one commit. Well, what happens if I go over here? Nothing, right? If I look at this right here, I don't see my changes and I don't see my file, right? Well, yeah, that makes sense because I haven't done a git push yet. Git push says, take all of my changes that are local and push it back up to, let's see if it's the, here we go. It just says, take all of my local changes and push them back up to where they came from, right? Or in this descriptive picture here, why don't we just take all of our code and push it somewhere else? So that's exactly what we're gonna do. We're gonna say git push. If we do git push, now it's telling us, hey, I enumerated these objects. Here's a bunch of other details that you don't necessarily care about yet. It just quantifying the changes is all it's doing. And then it's telling you here, this is exactly where I pushed the code to, right? So now it says, hey, I push master to master from origin to remote. So now if we go back here on the left, we're gonna see, hey, look at that, my changes are here, right? And here's all of that content I added. And also here's the update to the README I just had. So that's push in a nutshell, right? We are pushing to remote. The opposite of that is if I had pull. So let's say some changes happened. Let's say I wanted to remove this again. I'm just going to make a change in GitHub. Don't mind that. So I'm just making a change in GitHub. So now master remote is different from local, my local instance here, right? So if I do a git pull, it does the exact opposite of git push. It says, take all of the changes that are remote and pull them down to me, right? Pull, and it's going to tell me exactly what happens, right? It says, okay, here's all my objects that are enumerated, a lot of quantifying detail, and then here's where I'm pulling from, right? And then it gives me a short little list of here's what's changed. So what's changed is the README, right? So previously I had a hello world in my README, but if I go ahead and I say cat README, I'm going to see that, oh, my hello world disappeared. Well, that's because it was changed. And now I pulled those changes down to my local instance. I didn't edit that in here. I pulled it from GitHub, right? So that's push and pull in a nutshell. Go ahead. You had a question?
Okay. Yeah, I was trying to follow alongside you. And then after you pushed, I couldn't push anymore. And now I get this message that's like pulling without specifying how to reconcile divergent branches is discouraged. So how do I?
That may be because you don't have access to the repo.
I think I do now. So after I couldn't push, I pulled, and now I have Joe, but I had also modified the README file.
Yeah, you have discovered a future topic that we were about to get to in a few minutes called merge conflicts.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. This is exactly a great live example of how to create a merge conflict. We had an example set up. You may have created your own, which is kind of neat in its own way. The point is you, well, yeah, okay. I'll show you in a offhanded way how to reset that. Or you can just reclone later, and I'll let you guys start pushing to that repo, the workshop repo, in a bit. Maybe not pushing and pulling to the README like I am at this very moment. But anyways, a quick note on comments. Usually make them descriptive. If you keep making comments that are update change, right? Or actually, let me show you this because I don't think I've mentioned this yet. There's another command called git log, and I quasi showed you this in GitHub. So if you go to the repository and you're at the home page of your repository and you click on this little icon here, it's right below code most of the time. It's right below code, and it's this little arrow pointing back, and there's some number. If you click on that, it shows you a log of all of the changes, all of the commits you have made, right? And if you want to look at that same log, but locally, you just do git log. That's the command right here, git log. And it'll show you exactly what's going on. So it says, okay, my initial commit was earlier this afternoon, and this was my message, right? And then I made another commit, and I called it populate, and I did it at this time, right? And each of these have this in this brown here, each of these are a hash, a commit hash. And it's a unique identifier for each set of changes that you make. Each bundle of changes will have a hash. That'll be important for later. But for now, just keep that in the back of your mind. And then, of course, you can also see added the Joe file, right? And then, of course, this is a commit that I made in GitHub, not locally, but I still have it locally because I pulled it down. Updated README. That's when I removed hello world from the README. So that's what's going on here. There are also a lot of other things going on here. So these are git tags right here. And these, some of these are shorthands. You can also make your own custom git tags. Well, if we have time, we might go into tags and why they're useful. But for now, just know that they exist, right? So that's git log. And whenever you're creating commit messages, ideally what you want to do is you want to say, you want to describe what you're doing in a nutshell, right? So this is what I'm doing here. So I'm saying, this is what I did. And this is why I did it, maybe, or maybe not why, but in terse terms, describe what you did, right? And here's an example on the left. I think this is, once again, relevant XKCD. This happens quite a lot in industry. Happens more than I want it to, but unfortunately. All right, so that's pull in a nutshell. It's saying pull changes, push is the other way around. You're pushing local to remote. And then there's some other stuff. So get status, I showed you that. Get status is in the bundle of your staging phase, right? So in get, there is the make your changes phase, which is kind of ish the first phase. And then there's your staging phase, which is when you're telling Git, this is the file, these are the files, and these are the changes I want you to track and not track. And then your commit and publishing phase, right? So those are kind of loosely the three phases that happen in Git. So changes, staging, and commit/publishing. Git add always has to come before Git commit. That's something to something important to know. So if I say, if I made another file called Apple, let's say, right? Well, if I made a new file called Apple and I decided, hey, you know what? I'm going to make a bunch of changes and I'm going to make a bunch of new files, and I did git commit. If I tried to do git commit without adding, this is what's going to happen. It's going to say on branch master, your branch is up to date with origin master. Well, why did that happen? Well, it happened because I didn't tell git yet to start tracking this new file that I added. So this is kind of a critical point of why you need to make sure that your add comes before commit, is because you're quite literally trying to tell Git how to differentiate what's important and what's not. So that's why we do git add Apple. And then now if we do git status, we have that, and then git commit blah, right? There's this little shorthand here that I use all the time. This is git commit AM. You can add flags. So instead of directly going through the editor, you can add a flag. And if your message is only going to be a one-liner, you can say git commit A-M. And what this says is add a singular line commit message, and in quotes, just add your message like this, and it'll do this same process. Or I could just say git commit and it'll open the editor, and I add it in, and then I save and quit. It's all the same process, right? So if I do git log, there you go. There's my brand new commit, and here's its hash, and it's signed by me. And it's what this is telling me here, these tags are telling me here, is head master, i.e. my local head, is one commit ahead of origin master, right? And all that's saying is I have changes that are local that are not in remote yet. So that's that in a nutshell. Git diff, this is actually a great time to show that off. So head one origin head one. Git diff says, show me the difference between this and this, right? So diff stands for difference, and it's all in the name. So what I'm saying here when I say git diff head one origin head one is I'm saying compare my local head, i.e. compare the front of the line in my local repository to the front of the line remotely. And it's going to tell me exactly what those changes are. It says remotely you have all of this stuff, but locally you have all of this stuff plus whatever is in green, if that makes sense. So basically, remote has all of these changes, but locally, I only have these changes and they don't exist remotely. So I need to make sure that that's up to date at some point. And then of course, another one is git log tree. This is a way to visualize what the tree looks like. It's a good way to visualize what's going on. This one is not that interesting because so far it's a vertical line, but I can show you guys maybe what a more slightly more interesting one looks like. I can show you tree. So I'm doing the same command. So I'm doing git log graph here. And what it's doing, if I kind of zoom out a little bit more, it's showing me what the tree looks like. So think of a git tree as a real tree. What you have at the base is you have the trunk of the tree. And as the tree goes up, it branches out, right? And a bunch of branches, sometimes branches have branches. And they all branch out. Now, the thing that's a little bit different between real trees and git trees is those branches eventually merge back into the trunk. At least that's what good tree management looks like. In summary, this is what the workflow looks like, right? So you have git pull, meaning get your content, or maybe git clone. You make some changes, and then you say git add, get commit, and then you get push, and then everything is pushed back stream. Right, I forgot we had this slide for a second. My apologies, I'm jumping forward a little bit fast, but this is a visual representation here of what this looks like. So you can either create the new repository from scratch, or you might be cloning it. In case of Orsat, you will be cloning just about everything. I don't think you guys have, you don't have rights to create new repositories. You're going to add your changes, and then you're going to stage them, and then you're going to commit them, and then you're going to push them, meaning pushing it out to remote. So when you're thinking of push and pull, you're always thinking of it as you-centric, local-centric. So when I'm pushing away from me, i.e. I'm pushing remote. When I pull, I'm pulling towards me. I'm pulling from remote to me. Maybe a quick little way to remember the difference between those two things. Right, okay, and then now we get into branches. So branching is, you can think about this entire process as if it's a tree, a real tree. So in this particular case, we have a trunk. And if we go all the way to the bottom of this tree on the right here, this is the trunk. There's a lot of, there was only one branch, and that one branch was master. And then at some point along the line, I started making branches. And branches diverge from master, but eventually, if you follow this line up here, it diverges, but then it merges back into master, right? And of course, that makes sense, hopefully, because you want your changes to be incorporated into your main product. And you can kind of think master. If you're trying to add new features, but you're trying to also take advantage of branches, you can think of master as being your sort of production, copy of what it is you're trying to work on, right? So when you're working alone, you tend to work only in master because it's just you. But when you're working collaboratively, it's actually kind of important that you don't work in master almost ever, because you're trying to treat master as your centralized product, and you're just merging things into master over time as you're adding new features, as you're fixing new bugs, and all of that jazz, right? So a lot of fancy things can happen. Sometimes you get derivations of derivations, like what's going on here. We have a branch that merged off of, branched off of master. Sorry if I get that backwards. Branching is when you diverge. Merging is when you come back in. And we'll revisit that in a second here. We branched off here, and then once I branched off here, we branched off again, and then we merged twice back into master. Sometimes that can happen, and sometimes that's useful, depending on what it is we're doing. Here it is happening again. So we've merged off of master, or actually, no, I don't think that's a double. It's not a double branch there, but. Here's just some examples of what it looks like, at least. And whenever you're trying to think of versioning, again, just think of it as branches on a tree, on a regular literal tree. Okay, great. That's branching in a nutshell, but how the heck do we use it? Well, right now I'm in master, and if I want to create a new branch for me to work in, I just do git checkout dash b, and then the branch name, right? So now you can see in my shell, it also gives me a nice little indicator as part of my shell, but you might not get this, but it tells me, hey, you're in Dmitry Dev. But if you don't have this, and maybe you're just using regular bash, another way to check is you can say git branch. And what this does is it pulls up a little menu and it says, here's all the branches that you have available to you. And the one that's in green, this is where you are. Plus the little star here. It says, I am in Dmitry Dev, right? So great. That's git branch. And let's say I make another change to README. And let's say I just add a bunch of white space to the README for the sake of change, right? And then I go through the regular workflow. Well, what's the regular workflow? Well, you do git add, right? So I've git add, and if I do git status, it'll show me, hey, you modified README. So I say, okay, great. I want to commit now. So I commit. And I say, updated README. Great. So now if I do a git log, what am I going to find? Well, I have this commit updated README, right? And I'm in this particular branch, or in this particular line of history, I have updated README, and head is at Dmitry Dev, right? But if I go ahead and I switch back over to master, so I do git checkout. If I want to check out a branch that already exists, I do the same command before, except just without that dash B option. So I just say git checkout master, like that. So when we're creating, we add the dash B like that. When we're just switching to a pre-existing one, we just do git checkout. Okay, great. Now I'm back in master. What happens if I check the log again? Well, I don't see my log anymore because that change was not committed to master, it was committed to my branch. And I want those changes to be back in master. So how do I do that? Well, that's where merging comes into play, right? So now that I've created changes in another branch and I want it to be reincorporated into master, what I have to do is I have to change into the branch that I want the changes to be merged into. This is kind of important. Some tools get this somewhat backwards. Git does it this particular way. You want to be in the branch that you're trying to merge changes into. And you want to say git merge that branch. So in this case, git merge Dmitry Dev. So that means I have changes that are in Dmitry Dev, but I'm in master. And I want those changes to come here to master. So I say git merge. And now it says, great, I'm going to merge all of those changes. This is a fast forward, and I'm not going to explain what that means for now. And here's a short list of all of the changes that happened. There were 8 additions to the README file. And now if I do git log again, I'm going to find those changes. Great. So now I've reincorporated those changes. And if I do git tree, let me do the exact one, because that's an alias. Let me check out. exact same. Git, it's just git log graph. All right, great. So now what I'm going to see is I have those changes, and it kind of looks like a chunk because it just did a linear fast forward. We might show you a non-linear fast forward later if we have time. But that's a merge in a nutshell. It says, okay, I'm going to take those changes and put it back into the trunk of the tree, so to speak, right? Felix, that question you were asking earlier about, you're getting an error message saying there were conflicts, right? In a nutshell, what I was telling you is there are conflicts, right? So what's a merge conflict? Well, a merge conflict is, in essence, you can think of merging, actually, here's hopefully a better analogy. You can think of merging in Git as the same as merging cars in a road, right? Let's say you're a red car that's on the right of a lane. You're in the rightmost lane, and you're trying to merge into the center lane. And there's a blue car that's in the left lane also trying to merge into the center lane. What happens when both the red and the blue car try to merge into the center lane at the same time? Well, you get a collision, or in this case, you get a conflict. So you have to reconcile that conflict somehow, right? And a merge conflict is Git telling you, hey, I have change A and change B, and both of them are trying to change the same thing at the same time, and I'm not sure which one you actually want. So which one do you actually want? That's merge conflicts in a nutshell. So I'll give you a kind of demo of So this is what a conflict looks like, actually. This is probably important to show off. This is what a conflict looks like right here. Maybe you say you've made a bunch of changes and you've gone through the regular workflow and you're ready to push all of your changes back up to remote. And you do that and you go through the authentication phase, and then it says rejected. Master, non-fast forward. Failed to push refs. Updates were rejected because the tip of your current branch is behind. What that's telling you in a nutshell is, hey, there's some master changed while you were gone. You went out to lunch and you made a bunch of changes, and then you came back and master changed. So the base of master that you started with is not the same as the base of master of where you're trying to merge in now. Or in a maybe a more intuitive sense, the red car and the blue car are trying to merge into the lane, or maybe the blue car already merged into the center lane, and now you're the red car trying to merge into that center lane, but the blue car is already there. So now you have to reconcile that difference. And that can be a very painful process, and that can also be a painful setup. Most merge conflicts can be avoided. There are exceptions to this rule, and sometimes there are different reasons why they might happen. Some of the reasons why they might happen is somebody is working in master. They're not working in their own branch. Somebody is working in master, and other people are working in their own branches. And as master is changing over time, people working in their own branches try to merge back into master, but the differences between your own custom branch and master are different, such that Git doesn't know which changes you want and which you don't. And we'll give a live example of this, actually. This is kind of a sort of text-based example, I guess you could say. Line 123 of Hello World is changed on branch dev Evan. Line 123 of Hello World is changed on branch Joe. Joe tries to merge the changes from Evan, but Git doesn't know whose change should take priority. So that's kind of a linear example, right? Let's do a real world example. So here's what's going to happen. We have this repository here, Git Workshop. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to check out my own branch here. right? So I'm in my own branch. I do git branch and I find out, hey, there I am. There's master that's available and there's me. There's git Dimitri dev right down there in green. So that means I'm in Dimitri dev. And I'm gonna go into my list directory and I'm going to open up the fruits file. And let's say I want to add another fruit. Let's say I want to add tangerine, right? But simultaneous to this, while all of this is going on and I'm going through my normal development, Joe is in master right now. And he's also changing fruit line one, and he's going to add something else to line one there. And that is going to change sort of the plane of where the baseline of what changes are in master, right? So let's say Joe goes into fruit and he adds on line one, what's another fruit? Do we have orange, cherry.
Banana.
Or banana, yeah, there you go. So let's have Joe add banana to line one of the fruits list, right? And I'm just gonna wait for him to add that. And then meanwhile, I'm going through my regular work cycle, right? So I have a bunch of untracked files, so I want to add them. So I say, okay, there we go. Start tracking the fruits changes, the changes that are happening in fruits. So I do git status again, and git says, hey, I'm tracking the changes in fruit. And so I say, okay, great, let's commit that.
I actually also had to merge down the changes you had.
Oh no. Can you just reclone it real quick? Or I mean, you can also just reset.
Yeah, it would help if I didn't keep mistyping my SSH password.
Yeah, okay, so Joe is the rare breed of people that actually put passwords on their SSH keys. So here I am, I'm adding. So I updated fruits, right? And I committed it. So locally I have changes to fruits. And now, okay, there we go. So Joe has now changed in master. He changed the first line to banana. So let's say I want to go into
And incidentally, creating your SSH keys with passwords is nice if you have to, like, you know, store them in a place where you're not entirely sure if other people can get to them.
Yeah, that's true. So if you're on a shared machine and you don't necessarily trust other people that are on your shared machine, putting a password on there is nice. Okay, so I'm gonna do a git pull here. If you have divergent branches, then specify how to reconcile them. What in the nut? Oh, okay, this is the. Whoops, pull. There we go. Okay, I'm actually doing an extra merge here, but we're going to ignore that for the time being. So the moral of the story is origin master is now here, right? And here's Joe's commit right down here. An extra merge happened. The only reason an extra merge happened is because I think I changed my master as well. and I didn't push that back up yet. That's the only reason that happened. And that is also what happened to you as well earlier, Felix. But the important thing here is Joe's change is down here. Change apple to banana, right? So if I go into lists and I say, I check out the contents of fruit, there we go, there's banana, right? So now let's say I want to reconcile my changes with Joe's. So I say git merge Dimitri dev. Uh-oh, what's this? Auto merging list fruits. Conflict, merge conflicts and list fruits. Well, okay, let's go check out list fruits. So I go into my list directory and I check out the contents of fruits again. Whoops, there's all of this, what looks like jarble here, right? So it's saying, hey, head, banana, these equal signs for some reason, tangerine apple, and then Dimitri dev, right? What is this right here? Well, this is a merge conflict. And anytime a merge conflict is happening, again, go back to the fundamentals. Git is saying, hey, you have two things changing the same thing at the same time. I don't know which change you want. All Git is going to do at that point is it's going to insert this exact form of content into everywhere where there's a change conflict. So it's going to do it in this format every time where it says, this content up here from between these two indicators here, head, is this. So what this is saying is, this is the content that was in head, i.e. this is the content that was already in master. And then down here, between these equal signs and this indicator here, this is all the content that was in your branch, the branch you were just trying to merge in. So what Git is telling me right here is it's saying, here's what's in master right now. Here's what you're trying to merge in. These two changes are not equivalent, so I don't know which changes you want to keep. So now it's up to you to tell Git, I'll go with that for now, exactly what things you want in that file. Now you can, this is called conflict resolution, merge conflict resolution. You can do this one of multiple ways. You could manually edit the file, which is what some people do. So let's say I go into this directory and I see, oh, Joe added banana, but I also added these two entries. Let's say, hey, screw Joe, I don't want banana. I just want my changes in there. I just say, delete all of the contents that was in head, between head and the equal sign there, and just replace it with my own, right? And now if I say cat fruits, there you go. Now all of that content is updated, right? Okay, great. But I have this little star in master, and if I equivalently just did git status, it would tell me, hey, both modified fruits, there was unmerged content that was not reconciled yet. You haven't told git the merge has been resolved. The merge conflict has been resolved yet. So how you would reconcile this is you would say git merge continue. Whoops. Oh, git add. See, there you go. Even I forget sometimes. And then you do git merge continue. And now you get this, you get thrown into your editor again because it's trying to say, hey, you're basically creating a brand new commit, but the commit is the conflict resolution here. And all you're doing is you're saying, these are the changes that in the end I want, right? And you're just trying to give this a name. Most of the time it autofills for you. Hey, I'm merging Dimitri dev into master. And that usually indicates you were resolving a conflict of some kind. It even tells you, it gives you information here that tells you what happened. And if you don't want to change the default, you can just keep it as is. And you say, all right, merge continue, merged branch Dimitri dev into master. So now if I do git log, it'll say, hey, here's this brand new change. Here's where we were just a second ago with master. Joe changed apple to banana. And then I came along and I tried to update fruits in Dimitri dev. But then we came up here to merging time and merge didn't happen because there was a conflict of data there, a conflict of changes. So I said, okay, I'm going to just say screw Joe and only add my changes back. And I re-merged it together and put it into that. right? I am going to grab I'm going to grab this one actually. So let's take let's look at another way, a more modern way of dealing with merge conflicts. So if I try to do the same thing again, okay, I get the same conflict. All I was doing there was I was just resetting the stage to where we were with at the time of conflict. And now let me show you, you can manually edit files, but you can also use tools that sort of take care of it for you a little bit. Let's add this project file. Okay, great. So now I have this, all right, so I have lists, right? And inside of lists, I have a conflict. What some tools do for you is they sort of parse out that standardized, the standardized way that GitHub tells you where a conflict is. It always looks like this. So the arrow brackets pointing left always tells you what's in the sort of more up-to-date segment, and the lower arrow brackets tell you what you're trying to merge in. And then the middle bracket says this is the border here. And you can say, hey, I want to use this or I want to use this. So let's say I wanted to go with Joe's changes instead of mine. I can click a button and it'll take care of that. Now we've resolved the change part of this, but we haven't yet told Git that we've resolved it. So there's two parts to resolving merge conflicts. And the first part is making the change, first of all. And then the second part is telling Git that you made the change, right? So you say git add, and then you say git merge continue. And then it pops us into the same editor again. And you say, okay, that's fine. I want to tell Git that I am merging, that is my commit message. I am merging my branch into master. And now if we take a look at it again, it will let us know. And then now if I get push back up to GitHub, now it's going to reconcile those changes. And if I take a look at the history, it's going to show us those changes. So here we go, merge branch Dimitri Dev into blah, right? So what it's telling me is the changes that Joe did back here, stayed, they didn't change, plus my other changes that I had made. Earlier I had made all of this white space in the README, that has now been changed. It's very tricky, and there are a lot of different variations of the same situation that make conflicts happen. So this can get very painful, especially when you sort of amplify the amount of files there are, the amount of directories there are, and in addition to that, the amount of people there are on a project. So the easiest way to sort of deal with merge conflicts is to avoid them in the first place, right? Oh yeah, and then of course here's another example here. We'll share the slides when we are done with the workshop, so you guys can take a look at these later if you'd like. Right, and then these are that was the part I just went over. So the best way to sort of deal with merge conflicts is avoid them in the first place, which usually looks like a couple of best practices. Number one, don't work in master. Don't work in main, especially if you're not alone. If you're working with multiple people, then it's kind of assumed that everybody has their own branch, or at least there's one branch per new feature. There are a couple different ways to slice that standard And not everybody does it consistently, but at the very least, everybody has their own branch and you work in that branch until you're ready to merge it back into master, and you're treating master as sort of your production copy of your product, whatever it is, right? And you're never really working in master unless you're doing a couple of caveat things like get actions or the other thing that I wanted to go over is sometimes merges go right and sometimes they go wrong. An example of when they go right, let's say I'm back in Dimitri Dev real quick. And let's say I update cars. And let's say I just remove a couple of lines here from cars, right? And let's say at the same time that, once again, at the same time that I'm updating Dimitri Dev, let's say that Joe is in here updating sports. And let's say he's maybe adding or removing some stuff from sports.
Why did you choose sports? Now I have to think of sports.
You can just remove one of the lines. It's fine. It doesn't have to be that. So if I look at my changes, I'm in my own world in Dimitri Dev here in my branch, and I have my log. I have my commit here that says updated cars, right? And if I switch on over to master again, and I do a pull whenever Joe gets that up, and I do a pull, and then I try to merge again, what we're gonna see is it's gonna go through, right? Sometimes, a lot of times, merges can automatically happen. And actually we saw that already a few times this workshop, it was very subtle and I kind of breezed over it. But a lot of the time merges can happen and merges do happen without you knowing. The only time you know you're aware, painfully aware of when a merge is happening is when there is a conflict. There we go. So git pull. So now I have a bunch of stuff in sports locally. So those are all of Joe's changes. And we can see that Joe did in fact make the commit, and I have that logged here. So now if I try to do a git merge Dimitri Dev into master, I'm merging Dimitri Dev into master. So I'm pulling content from Dimitri Dev to master. It's all going to go through. There's no conflicts. The reason why there was no conflicts is because Joe and I were in two separate files, and there was no sort of conflict of change there. So that is merging done right, so to speak. We weren't stepping on each other's toes. And you could think of it as, the red car on the right and the blue car on the left, merging, but they're merging into the center lane at separate times. So that means that, or in separate places, I guess you could say, which means that there's no conflicts. Everything kind of flows nicely. And, you're not fighting for space, so to speak, right? Conflicts happen for two reasons. One, when you're working in master and you're changing the baseline on other people. So the moral of that story is don't work in master. And then two, if two people are trying to work on the same file at the same time. Sometimes that has to happen. Sometimes that's unavoidable. So if that does happen, then a good technique for avoiding conflict is collaborate and communicate, i.e., let's say Joe and I are both working on a certain script in one of the repos. We both have to work on it at the same time. Maybe both of us understand which lines are we changing, or maybe one of us, maybe we do some pair programming and instead only one of us is making the commits, but we're kind of working together, or we just sort of make some kind of agreement that says, okay, you don't touch this file because I'm working on it. Or don't touch that file because you're working on it. collaborate and communicate is key here, right? So don't just change files that you know or even you suspect other people may be working on. And if you see them changing a file, talk to them first before you're trying to make changes to that file. That is especially key once you get into the industry, because not only is that going to cause conflicts, but it's also considered rude when you just start changing files that other people are working on without really telling them. Very, very rude. So it's kind of just a courtesy thing as well. Another reason why, this one's a little bit harder to show by example because it takes time for this one to show, but sometimes, you know, I can show you the Git tree again, right? And here's the Git tree. Sometimes you make a branch and you're working on that branch for a really, really long time and you haven't, and master is changing parallel to that. But let's say for the sake of example, people are working in their own branches and they're just merging into master over time. So, they're merging into master over time and master is changing, but you're still in your branch that you've branched off a long time ago. And then you try to merge in maybe a year from now. There's inevitably going to be conflict there because your branch is stale. Stale just means changes happen to master in your current branch that you are in doesn't have those changes. That's what stale means, right? So, let's say, for instance, Joe made another branch, and in that branch, he made a bunch of changes, and one of those changes was to delete the sports file altogether. And let's say before he even did that, I made a branch that added a bunch of sports. But before I merged those changes back, Joe merged in his changes to delete the file. So by the time I'm trying to merge my changes of adding sports to that file is gone. Well, that's a conflict, right? Now Git's confused and saying, hey, this was already deleted. What do you want me to do? So that's another way that conflicts can happen. A way to avoid that particular issue is by fetch and merge often. One of the standards that's suggested sometimes is fetch and merge at the beginning of every session. That's not always practical because sometimes you don't want to, like sometimes you're in the middle of making a bunch of changes and you don't want to, you don't necessarily want to upset that yet. You don't necessarily want to pull in the original branch, pull in master yet until you're done. But, as soon as you can, or as soon as you're aware that there are some critical differences between what's on your branch and what's in master, fetch and merge those things often. And that's something I didn't quite cover, but git fetch just means, hey, grab all of the information about the changes that have happened remotely. And I'm not going to go too into detail on this, but git pull is actually just comprised of git fetch in sequence of git merge. Git pull is equal to these two commands here. Every time you say git pull, it's doing these two things. So it's saying fetch all of the changes that have happened remotely. Don't apply them to your repository. Just fetch all of the log, the record book of all of the changes that have happened. And then git merge says apply those changes locally. So you can do git fetch and git merge separately at any time. And if you want to do both of them in order, then you do git pull. But git fetch alone will at least tell you, hey, by the way, there are 5 new branches that are opened. And if you wanted to check out any of those branches, then you would say git fetch, and then you would do git checkout of that branch. So if Joe made a new branch here on this, in this workshop, and I wanted it, well, it doesn't automatically sync that Joe made the new branch. So if I did git branch, I can see these are all the branches that are available to me. But if Joe made Joe dev here, I would have to say git fetch. And then once I had done git fetch, it would show up in this menu. And then I could say git checkout Joe dev as an example there. So that's merge conflicts in a nutshell. It's very difficult to deal with merge conflicts, especially as the project grows, it becomes even more difficult. So these are some of the sort of key points to keep in mind when you are when you're collaborating, especially. This isn't particularly important. Merge conflicts are a lot more rare if you're working alone, just because that's probably the exception to the rule of don't work in master. Well, if you're the only one, then you're really only using it as a history timeline, a linear timeline. But if you're working collaboratively, that's not really an option anymore. All right, so there's a couple of advanced things. So I've shown you this a couple of times now, but in practice, this is what a Git tree looks like. You know, multiple branches can be made and they eventually merge back into master. Most of the time they're merged back into master. Branches can be made and then they can branch off of branches. And then those branches can be merged into master again. That's just adding layers of the same process all over again. The process is no different when you do that. It's just adding more branches to the process. So fundamentally the same things are happening. So while I'm getting at. Right. Okay. So now we're kind of getting towards the end of the workshop, I think. So GitHub features, I've kind of overviewed them a little bit here, but there's the organizations, GitHub organizations. So we have one. It is called Orset. Hopefully everybody is already a part of this. Something else that is a feature that GitHub has is issues. And issues are actually one of the primary ways that we track feature requests and bugs. That's kind of just a quirk of how GitHub does their project boards, and I'll get into that in a second. But this is what a bug report looks like in GitHub. You say open a new issue, and then it can see some fields to add some content, whatever content you desire. They use Markdown. So if I wanted to make a title, I'd say, this is a title. And if I want to make a bullet point list, right? And they even give me a little tab here to preview what the Markdown looks like. That's issues in a nutshell. Relatively intuitive once you kind of get into it. Something else that they have are assignees. So you're saying, hey, I want to assign this person to the issue. I want to assign Dimitri, or in this case, Joe, right? Let's say I want to assign Joe to this problem. Maybe remove my, Joe, there we go. It's what it's gonna do is it's gonna alert Joe, hey, this issue was created and you were assigned to it. So now Joe is gonna get a little alert that says, you should look at this. Labels, pretty self-explanatory. They're little tags, so it helps you keep track of things, especially in the project boards, and I'll show you that in a second. So in this case, you can label this as a bug. Third projects, don't worry about these too much actually, and milestones. Those are extra features that are not necessarily relevant quite yet. But then you hit submit and then there you go, there's a bug, right? And now it's just like any kind of social media thread system or forum that you probably have seen before. This is all self-explanatory. This is how we track bugs, especially some best practices. there are sometimes templates. Sometimes we set up templates for bug reports and it'll fill out some of this content for you, or it'll provide fields. So fields like how did you produce this error, or you know, steps to reproduce, a space for images. Like if you want to insert images into your bug report and take a screenshot of some kind of faulty software or something like that. It's good to always describe in a step pattern how you reproduce the problem. That is one of the best practices of reporting bugs. Always provide a sort of description of the process you followed to get to the bug, not just a description of what the bug is. And then of course, provide that too, but very important. So another thing that we have are Kanban boards or project boards. Actually, I don't think we can see the Kanbans anymore because I think Ryan switched us over, but they're mostly the same, just in a more Excel spreadsheet form. So what these look like are this. And all of these are linked to Git issues. So if I click on any of these, it links me to an issue that has been opened. So here is one issue. And then it is linked to the project board and it has a bunch of extra attributes like a Excel spreadsheet. We're not totally there yet, but this is how we're going with how we want to start managing our projects. And you can do things like you can in bulk manage who's assigned to what, a status. So we have a little status column and then of course labels, just tags to help categorize. And then of course the repository it's assigned to. Each repository could have its own project, but I think we're doing kind of these master boards things. I think that's the way we're going with this organization. All right. So one of the last things I definitely want to mention and definitely want to go over are forks. So another major feature of free and open source software are forks. So if I go to github.com and I look for anything at all, let's say I search for the Linux kernel, right? I search for the Linux kernel. And here we go. Here's a mirror of the Linux kernel. Let's say I wanted to add some features to the Linux kernel, and I want to eventually incorporate it into the upstream repository. Well, that's great. And I am free to do that. And I'm also free to build my own iteration of the Linux kernel, except there's one problem. I'm not part of the Linux Foundation organization. So I would be considered an outside contributor. So if I was an outside contributor, then what I would do is I would say, I want to hit this button here called fork. And what that's going to do is it's going to create a copy and I'm going to assign it to me. I could assign it to organizations, but I'm not going to. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a copy of the Linux kernel official repository. And then I'm going to make my changes. And when I'm ready, I'm going to create a pull request in my repository. And I'm going to say, take all of my changes and try to point them upstream to this repository here, right? This is if I'm an outside contributor, meaning if I went back to this repository here, the Torvalds Linux, I'm not part of the Linux Foundation, so I don't have write access to this repository. I don't have write access to this and permissions to modify it and all of that. So this is how I would go about doing this as an open source contributor, right? If I was a member of the Linux Foundation, then a fork is not necessary because I would be an inside contributor. And that's exactly the situation that you guys will be in. So forking is specifically for if you're not in the organization. That's what it relates to. Or sometimes there are other situations where you'd want to fork, I'm not going to get into too much detail there, but the moral of the story is you can fork repositories, and we have had things forked from other people who are just interested in the project in general. But it's not necessary if you are already a part of OrthSet and you're already part of the organization. Instead of forking, you just do a clone. That's something that's kind of important that I wanted to establish. So that's forking. And there's a difference between an outside and inside contributor. And that's kind of part of the free and open source software culture. And then, of course, pull requests. Pull requests are basically merges. So we can take this pull request, for example, right? So we have Nick Embry over here, and he was trying to merge some content into master. And we put down comments, we put down labels and stuff, and run some other stuff going on. And this is a merge, except it's a merge that's happening in GitHub. That's all it is in a nutshell. It's a merge, but happening in GitHub, rather than trying to merge locally on your own repository. And there are other things that there are things that are useful about doing it in GitHub versus doing it locally, namely so that we can run GitHub actions. Actions are a little bit more complicated, but actions are kind of like jobs, right? I want to run a set of commands that happen at a particular interval or a particular trigger, and I want those to run every time something happens. Like, I want a set of commands to happen every time somebody opens a pull request to merge into master. In this case, we have unit tests that run, and every time somebody wants to merge something into master, they have to pass the unit tests. And if they don't pass the unit test, then the actions will fail. It'll give us a little build status that says, hey, your unit test failed. So that's going to block this pull request from being able to be merged. So pull requests and GitHub actions kind of go hand in hand in that way. So closing tips. So get SEM. So get SEM. That's the website that I had pointed to earlier. This website right here, this tells you everything and anything. So like, if I wanted to know something about cherry picking, like let's say I wanted to learn about, okay, interesting. Oh, there we go. All right, I just needed to add a space there. But if I wanted to learn about cherry picking, it has all of the documentation on that. Also the same or similar amount of linkage and documentation exists. And if you just simply look up man get every day, as pointed to before, there are online mirrors of all of the man pages, the manual pages. So get every day, and then it's man7.org, it looks like. So those are some resources that should help be helpful. Here are some other links. Again, we'll give the slides out as part of this, so you can look at these links on your own time. Stack Exchange, YouTube, all that. Hopefully this will be on YouTube at some point. But also there are a lot of other great tutorials on the more complicated things, like Rebase. And then there's a link to the previous workshop that we did. So those are some resources. And I think that concludes the workshop. Are there any other questions, closing thoughts, or things that you quickly wanted to ask about? All right. Well, I think as kind of a added exercise, here's what we can do. As an added exercise, let's say I want to make a folder. And let's say I wanted to get poll first. And I'll make a directory. Just call it there. All right, let's do this. I'm going to add a directory, and I'm just going to say, make a file in here with your name in it, or as your name, like that. And let's say add a note. And then commit it to the repo, commit it to this repo. As kind of an exercise here. Like that. So as a sort of closeout sort of exercise, let's say I have this directory in here. What I want you guys to do is I want you to make a new file, put some kind of note in here, whatever you want, just work safe, of course, and make the file name, your first name. Just to kind of get an example of the Git workflow. And in the meantime, if you guys, again, have anything, any questions or anything you want to go over again, in the meantime, feel free to ask. Joe, you still good?
I am. I'm not sure if I'm muted though.
You are unmuted.
Okay. Well, then I'm still good.
Cool. Yeah,
thank you for that.
All right.
I think that's the first time I ever, pushed a commit. So I think you could start.
Yeah. The best way to.
First of many.
Yeah, the first of many. The best way to learn is to start using it. So, you don't have to do this, but as advice, if you guys are you guys CS students?
I'm a physics student. Right now coding with Arduinos. So I think I might be able to push my code from an Arduino, or at least for the Arduino. I don't know if this would be useful, but because right now what I'm doing is I've got it on a Google Drive. And so I don't know which one would be better. Because there's also, I'm not coding that from the command line. Like if there's the whole Arduino IDE, and all that kind
right.
of stuff.
Yeah, so Arduino has their own integrated environment and all that, and that's fine. Usually there are Git integrations with like everything. There are Git integrations with, I know Arduino has them. I don't know, it varies a little bit depending on which Arduino you have and what features and blah, blah, blah. But in general, Git is a powerful tool, even if it's only you in the repository, because I advocate for all CS students, use Git. You don't have to push to GitHub, but use Git because let's say you're working on a homework assignment and you're adding a bunch of stuff and you're merging it into master, or you're just updating master maybe, and then you keep adding stuff and you break something, right? Well, let's say you want to revert to a state where your code was working. Well, you can do that with Git, right? Mm-hmm. And it's also, if you do end up pushing to GitHub, you now have a backup of your homework. So that, you know, let's say your computer craps out, you got a backup, you're not worried.
So can you have a Git repository just on your local machine?
Mm-hmm. You can. It's a little more, you can do your own hosting if that's what you're asking. And you can also, you could also just init your own, right? So again, mm-hmm. let's say I'm in, this is not anywhere, right? So I make a new directory and call it demo again, right? Demo is just an empty folder right now, right? Demo is just an empty folder right now. There's nothing in here and it's not linked to anything. If I wanted just a Git repo locally, I'm not syncing it to anywhere, then I could do git init. And now I have a Git repo in here. And now I can start adding all of my files and start adding them to Git. And now I have a Git repo and it has commits in it, right? And I just created this, right? And you can use it locally. And then if I wanted to, push it to a remote server and have my backup, then I can do it via GitHub, right? So let's say I wanted to also make a demo and I wanted to make it public and I created it. Okay, great. Now I have this repository, but GitHub is telling me this is empty. So if I wanted to make it remotely, and then I also wanted to update my pre-existing repository, I could do git remote add origin. Origin is arbitrary name. All you're doing is you're saying origin is my remote repository name. I could call this GitHub for all I cared, right? Except Git is not going to recognize GitHub as the default remote. It's going to recognize origin as the default remote. So most of the time it's beneficial to just keep this named origin, but you could name it to whatever you want is the point I'm getting at. Okay, and there we go. So now I have origin in there. So, and I could check that by saying git remote, get URL origin. And now it tells me, hey, this is what your upstream repo is. This is where it's at, right? And now if I do git push, it'll say set upstream because upstream doesn't have any branches. That's why it's telling me this. And if I said set upstream origin master, I only have to do this once. This is a set and forget. And now it's pushed to my remote repo. And now I have all my files. And that's a way to do that.
So you talked also about a difference between branching and forking. So yes. Branching is what you do when you are a member of the organization. And then if yes. you're outside, you would make a fork.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff you're talking about went over my head, to be honest. But thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right.
I'm using GitHub Desktop right now. I just create a new branch with my name, Jin, and I open the folder and create a test document named testing. And then I click commit to my folder. So I wonder if my file will go to GitHub? Go to Git?
Are you? No, you're not. No, you're not, Joe. Sorry. Okay, so you're saying you were creating a directory and a new file.
Yeah, so on GitHub, I click new branch, and then I enter my first name, and then I think I click publish branch.
On GitHub, it looks like so are you talking about creating the branch locally? Or, because I don't see it on GitHub.
I don't think I create locally. I think I chose the first option that contribute to the OrgSat Geek Workshop 2022.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, added the Joe file, added Felix, okay. I don't see you in here. First you have to start by creating the branch locally. So again, how you do that is get branch and then dash B, sorry, not branch, get checkout dash B, and then the branch name. So you can call it whatever you want. Get checkout Apple, right? And now I have a branch called Apple, right? This command right here is how you create the branch locally. And then if you want to push it remotely, you say git push set upstream origin Apple, like that. See that?
And how do I get there? So on my computer, I open the command promotion or something like that. I'm not sure how to get there.
Sorry, I'm not following you.
Yeah, there's only one problem with me with the terminal stuff, that I opened the Eclipse CMD and then I opened the command window, but I don't know how to get help on that.
Okay, so you're on Windows?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So in the start menu, search for git bash.
Can you say again?
Git bash, B-A-S-H.
Okay.
So yeah, so this is the shell that you want to use when you're working with git, because you won't have access to it in the old school CMD shell.
Oh, so like that's I have to install git bash first?
Yes.
Okay, I see.
Yes. Git bash, here, I can find for you. Actually, I'll just start git bash. Let's see here. Git4windows.org, that's the website it's from. And I will post that in chat. Git4windows.org, that's where you can get git bash.
Git-scm is actually also a place you can get.
Be able to hopefully be able to push something back up. And I think I'm gonna call it there. It's 8:11. We're, I think, 11 minutes over where we intended to end. So I think I'm gonna call it there. If you guys have any other questions, of course, feel free to reach out to me on Slack. I think this will also be posted on YouTube again, if you'd like to review it there. All right. Well,
awesome. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you all for coming.
See y'all. Have a good night.
Thank you.